Hi everyone, hope you're having an amazing day wherever you are. Today, this episode I want to dedicate to XRP, and it seems like everyone is going gaga over XRP, and let's look at it why, right? First, we have XRP goes live on Huobi OTC. So Huobi is one of the largest crypto exchange. I think it's the fifth largest globally in terms of trading volumes, right? And their over-the-counter market, their over-the-counter crypto exchange is now listing XRP on 6th of March, right? So yesterday. And this is 6 coin listed. So it's very, very major news for XRP, right? Another avenue for basically people who want to trade XRP, another avenue for them. And OTC market is really good to for especially the whales or large players to trade, because it basically, you know, they can negotiate to Huobi OTC to say that I want to, you know, buy or sell huge amounts of XRP, and they will then arrange the buyer and seller respectively, and the trade will be smoothed over, so it won't have huge volatility on the overall market. So that's really something good, and definitely it increased liquidity. Yeah. Next, Mercury FX first commercial transaction successfully completed using XRapid. So it basically made history because the, you know, both they have using XRapid, basically that means using XRP token, they have done a global transactions both for personal use and also commercial use. For the personal one, it was for a honeymoon, right, from Mexico to Philippines, and for the commercial one is from UK to Mexico. So they have proven by using just XRP, the transaction can be super fast and at super low fees. And this kind of news, right, just strengthened the capability and of course the marketing, the making, the visibility, right, of making known this kind of news for everyone. Just again, support, right, why XRP is such a large market cap, such a large market cap coin, right? And next two news is really along the side that, you know, you have huge governments, regulators actually recognizing Ripple, and that's why they want, you know, their top management to be on their management or advisory team. So let's look at it. Ripple Consensus Quant Network among 105 founders to sign off on International Blockchain Association at European Commission. So today marked another significant milestone for global blockchain technology adoption after a notary deed to create the International Association of Trusted Blockchain Applications, or INATBA, was signed off on by 105 founding members at the European Commission's Brussels headquarters. Participating in a legal foundation were representatives of a host of well-known projects native to the crypto and blockchain ecosystem, such as Ripple, Consensus, Quant Network, IOTA Foundation, Neurosis, Unibright, and Madonna. And what does this association want to do, right? They really want to support the innovation and development of crypto and blockchain, but specifically they say maintain a permanent and constructive dialogue with the public authorities and regulators to help converge regulatory approaches to blockchain, promote an open, transparent and inclusive model of governance for blockchain and other distributed ledger infrastructure and applications. Third, support the development and adoption of interoperability guidelines, specifications and global standards. And four, create sector-specific guidelines and specifications for the development and acceleration of trusted sectorial blockchain and DLT applications in specific sectors. Now, this news, although it seems, again, it's not significant, but the fact that you have Ripple on this association, right, it clearly, right, speaks volumes that the industry itself do look up to Ripple and XRP as really, you know, one of the leading charge to bring the industry forward, because one of the key factors, of course, they have very, very professional people. A lot of their senior team members are from the financial industry who can definitely, you know, very comfortable speaking to regulators and about, you know, speaking the same language of financial systems, of banking, right? And yeah, so that is definitely, it's going to be easier when you want to engage the regulators, right, to support the crypto industry going forward. Next, Ripple co-founder and Circle CEO part of high-level advisory group for IMF. So IMF stands for International Monetary Fund. So the entry of cryptocurrencies and blockchain technology into institutional processes made news again, with the IMF High Level Advisory Group convening in Singapore. Then this was happening on March 1st, 2019, so a few days ago. The delegation aimed to discuss fintech process and how data and cybersecurity were key focus areas. The IMF stated that it will use the previously discussed Bali Fintech Agenda as the framework for the fund's engagement with its members. The official IMF release stated, following the launch of the Bali Fintech Agenda, developed by the IMF and World Bank, the fund is deepening its engagement with a broad range of public and private sector stakeholders. Now, this is key. Why? Because IMF actually have something they call a high-level advisory group for fintech. And this was formed in March 2017, so about 2 years ago. And at that time, they already have two very prominent individuals in the crypto space that we know. One is Chris Larsen, who is the chairman of Ripple and also co-founder of Ripple. Second is the CEO of Circle, which is Goldman, backed by Goldman Sachs, Jeremy Allaire. So these two people, and Ripple definitely is on there. So it just shows that, the IMF, and again, they really, so IMF is a really, really, is like central bank of the central bank of the world, right? And one of their key objectives or their mission statement is to increase the living standards of everyone globally. They really want to promote financial inclusion. That means everyone who are not banked today, they want to give them a chance to experience how actually banking or some sort of, participating in savings, lending, in the financial system. So it doesn't necessarily have to go through banks, because now we have a lot of crypto, right? But yes, so that's what IMF actually wants to do. And March 2017 already, they already had an advisory group. And at the time, they already have Chris Larsen, who is a top man in Ripple. Yeah, and that just shows you the kind of regard that the regulators have for companies like Ripple. So definitely very, very good news, for Ripple and XRP. Next, Binance CEO also seems to be an XRP army. So let's see what he says. So in CZ, who Changping Zhao, who is the founder and CEO of Binance, the largest crypto exchange by volumes today, this is his second Ask Me Anything session, and one of the parts, some of the questions were related to XRP, and he said, at first he said he doesn't want to talk about specific coins, but still, I think XRP is just too prominent that he has to talk about it. He started with a joke that says, quote, "I think if I talk about XRP anymore, I'm going to become one of those XRP armies," end quote. He then made this very interesting comment that's sure to simultaneously please the XRP community and anger Bitcoin maximalists. "People are aware that there's a lawsuit against XRP," he meant Ripple, of course, "on whether they are a security or not. Our judgment is that they are not." Now, take note again, CZ really think and Binance really think that Ripple and XRP are not a security, right? And that is why they have listed, they have supported XRP coin on their exchange for a long time, right? And Binance just listed them, right? And going back to the quote, "And until it's proven that they are, we listed them, and luckily we dragged other exchanges to list them." So this is another very key. Because Binance has taken the lead, other exchanges are also now listing XRP. So basically, it is very, very hard in the future, right? Because there's just so much demand now for this coin and pushing up their, their position and their market cap. So when something is very important, it's like too big to fail, right? When the banks are too big to fail, the analogy, right? In XRP case, they are like the number 3 or number 2 market cap coins by market cap, depending on which day you look, right? So, and similarly to those large banks that are too big to fail, government normally will give special treatment to this kind of coins or projects, because they are just too big to fail, So, that's the thing. And with a lot more exchanges listing XRP, this will just promote further the trading and market cap of XRP. Now, so back to his quote, that's a good thing. So just because there's a lawsuit doesn't mean that they are guilty. So we applied our judgment there, and we are always very supportive of XRP. There's a lot of guys who complain that it's overly centralized, but look, the market votes with their feet, and XRP is one of the largest market cap coins, and it's like that for a reason. So he said, there's a reason why there are so many people that really, really like XRP, right? And because of that, right, Binance, being a pro customer friendly crypto exchange, they also want to be, they really want to just list coins that are popular with people. Just want to make it very easy, very friendly for the customers. So yeah, so CZ is really, really a very legend. He's a true legend in the crypto space. You know, he has he's one of the very key individuals to advance the industry going forward with his huge array of projects, right? Binance Academy, which educate the incoming newbies, and Binance Charity, which really want to just illustrate the use case of blockchain, of cryptocurrency, beyond just investment purposes, right? So yes, so even such a legend is actually endorsing XRP. Just ought to tell you why everyone else is going gaga over XRP. Now, last one, Ripple CEO Brad Gullinghouse on JPM Coin. He said other banks won't use it. Now, during a fireside chat at the Chamber of Digital Commerce DC Blockchain Summit in Washington, Brad Gullinghouse, which is CEO of Ripple, said he thinks that it is great to have major financial players like JP Morgan leaning in to crypto. And he also said that is the only nice things he has to say about JPM Coin. Now, at another conference last week, Brad Gullinghouse recalled his quote, "This guy from Morgan Stanley was interviewing me. I said, so is Morgan Stanley going to use the JPM Coin? And he said, probably not. So, well, is Citi going to use the JPM Coin? Is BBVA? BBVA is a very large bank in Europe. Is PNC another large bank? And the answer is no. So take note again here. Here, so basically he's saying that other major financial institutions are not going to use JPM Coin. Why? Because if they also use JPM Coin, then, you know, they just have to. There's no linkage there. And why should these other banks trust JPM Coin, right? That they are offering, that their coin actually is backed by the amount of USD that they say they have, right? So there's, why should banks trust each other, right? They are all for-profit organizations, and they know very well that, right? They are the ones who actually caused the 2008 crisis, and they are the one who actually are the dishonest people, and of course they won't trust each other, right? So anyway, back to the news. Hence, Brad Gullinghouse suggested a bank creating its own stablecoin risks creating the very problems that DLT is supposed to solve. DLT, distributed ledger technology. And then he quote, so does that mean that we are going to have all these different coins? Are we back to where we are with lack of interoperability? I don't get it, right? And he end his comment by saying, very diplomatic and very professional person as usual, his quote, now back to my first answer, if it solves the first problem of JPM leaning into crypto, so yay, that's all I got. So basically he said, and he see that if JP Morgan coin is definitely going to bring more visibility to crypto, because now they are issuing something very, very similar to crypto, except that it is a private, you know, inside their own ecosystem only, and only can be used by their own clients, then that's all it is, right? Because they just bring visibility, and you know, even so, we can say that JP Morgan is also endorsing this cryptocurrency, and eventually, right, first they fight it and then they will join the thing, right? But apart from that, he doesn't see that, you know, everyone else will also use it, because that was one of the big concerns. If everyone use it, what will happen? Then JPM can be essentially like just a central bank, and then they can actually change the law, say, oh no, now we just temporarily, you know, unpack the JPM coin 1-to-1 ratio to USD. This is actually one of the fears stated first brought up by Anthony Pompliano in his newsletter. A very valid concern, because that's what the central banks and that's what the banks have done previously, right? And in the US, where President Nixon has actually said temporarily they want to just lift the peg of USD to gold, right? That $1 of USD is no longer pegged to $1 of gold. And at time, because he can get away, it's because he said it's temporary. But after that, right, everyone forgot about it, and then President Nixon was not held accountable, and no one questioned anymore whether the peg would be brought on. Until today, we still don't have that peg, right? And that is why USD can be printed out of control, and that led to huge inflationary pressures around the world, right? Started from US, but everywhere as well. And that is why cryptocurrency is so major, right? And that is getting back to this JPM coin. Why, right? We have to be very, very careful of what they are doing. Definitely something to watch, right? But the fact that Brett Gellinghaus actually asked Morgan Stanley, huge other banks, Citi, again, another huge US bank, that what are they going to use? And yeah, because they not likely, because they just won't trust each other, because they know themselves, they're all for profits, right? So yes, I'm hopeful, and it seems that I am agree to the risk is low, though of course we should still watch what JPM is doing, right? Because I mean, after all, 2 years ago, Jamie Dimon, who's the CEO of JPM, he is the one who condemned Bitcoin, saying Bitcoin is a scam, right? It will go to zero and he will fire any trader who trades Bitcoin. So then 2 years later, they are having something very similar to Bitcoin. So very, very sneaky, right? So yes, definitely something to watch, right? And yes, stay tuned. I hope you like this episode. If you do, please subscribe, please leave a like and leave a comment, and I hope to see you in the next episode. Thank you so much for watching.